Good morning, friends. Let us start with the first chapter of community medicine today. The name of the chapter is Man and Medicine. Okay. So, first of all, let me start with the introduction to the subject. The thing is that we talk a lot about disease and we neglect health. So here in community medicine, the whole focus of the subject is that we focus on health rather than as compared to disease. We'll be dealing about the details of health in later chapters. Right now, let us start with how medicine evolved over the ages, how the concepts have changed, and what is the current philosophy of health. So, first of all, there is a difference between health states of developed and developing countries. Now, this may not come as a shock to you. All of you know that the developing countries are far better as compared to the health status are concerned as compared to the developing countries. There are numerous differences between developed and developing countries, but to broadly make you understand the differences between developed and developing countries, I would like to tell you that in developing countries, we have majority of problems with infectious diseases, and in developed countries, we have majority of problems with non-infectious or so-called non-communicable diseases. So, in general, if you have a question or if you have an MCQ which asks about specific disease states in developing and developed countries, and you have all the options are either communicable or non-communicable, your work becomes very, very easy that you have to choose the non-communicable disease burden for developed countries and you have to choose the communicable disease burden for the developing countries. Okay, so this is very broadly, you know, there are a lot of differences between the developing and the developed countries, and a lot of data is given in your books. I do not expect you to remember that data fact to fact, but I do expect you, as I told you, to know the differences between majority of the diseases for making you easy. Developed countries, you have non-infectious disease burden. Developing countries, you have infectious disease burden. Plus, there are a lot of differences between the healthcare settings between developed and developing countries. In developed countries, the healthcare setup has emerged beautifully. They have got a lot of state-of-the-art healthcare setup, whereas in developing countries, that setup is defunct. So this has given rise to the next thing that you see on the slide, something called as social injustice. Social injustice means, is it right that the people of the developed countries enjoy a better health, whereas the people from the developing countries continue to have a deplorated health system? Because health is one of the basic tenets of human rights, if you have to see it like that. Health is non-negotiable. I cannot have better health for developed countries people and less than better health for developing countries. So health is a basic parameter. I want across the platform everybody to have a satisfactory level of functioning as well as a satisfactory level of health. So for this gives rise to a notion of social injustice that people from developed countries have better health and people from developing countries are not that privileged. So this is the concept of social injustice. The next point is health for all for WHO. We will be talking about this in detail and you will be seeing a lot about health for all from the Alma-Ata declaration, and you will be revised many times in this. So don't worry about health for all by WHO, that is the World Health Organization. Coming to the next slide, let us start. As I told you, we'll start from the beginning and we'll see how medicine evolved, what was the evolution, what were the strong points, what were the failures, what led to another, and let us start very from the beginning, that is primitive medicine. So in primitive medicine, I mean to say times of antiquities, like ages, many, many years ago. So at that point of time, medicine was basically dominated by evil spirits. All the students who are listening to me who are from India very well know that in India, till today, primitive medicine is practiced. Many diseases are attributed to evil spirits or the wrath of gods, and you will be taken to a quack for that matter, and he'll treat you. I myself was treated for headache by a bush being hit on my head, and that was a local quack. So I know that most of you also have these kinds of remedies. If you have boils, if you have furuncles, you know, sometimes your grandmother or somebody from your house takes a chili and a lemon and they do some circles over your head and they throw it on the road. So these kinds of therapies, which have got no scientific basis but are still practiced, were the tenets of primitive medicine, where we thought that these are the issues with evil spirits. As I said, they are still found in India. On the slide we can see that concept of disease was believed to be supernatural theory of disease. So this very concept is called as supernatural theory of disease. Self-explanatory, called supernatural because we did not know anything about the disease, nor did we know anything about health. So we said that anything that we have is the wrath of gods. To give you some notable examples, I'll have to talk about tuberculosis. You can have an example of leprosy. Okay, tuberculosis was classically considered a wrath of god disease. Leprosy also. So leprosy was attributed to the sins of the past life. Okay, so these are the classical examples of the supernatural theory of disease. Disease is attributed to wrath of gods, the invasion of evil body by evil spirits. So those are the other explanations that are given in primitive medicine. And medicine was practiced as prayers, rituals, as well as sacrifices. Again, you know, some of the sacrifices still continue. Some unfortunate incidents have also happened in the recent past. You know, if you're following the media, if you're following the news, you know that some of children have been captured and butchered for health reasons. Okay, one of the very common misunderstandings, or shall I say superstitions, that is still prevalent in India is that having an unprotected sexual intercourse with a minor will cure you of a sexually transmitted disease. And till date, recently I read a news paper article that this is still being practiced, and a lot of girls are being raped on the context of getting cure from sexually transmitted disease. Obviously, there is no need for even me to tell you that this is not correct or this is not right. Okay, so as I said, rudiments of preventive medicine still persist, and you can still widely see them distributed all over. Coming to the next slide, we'll talk about Indian medicine. I think you have some knowledge about Indian medicine beforehand, but we'll see some of the legends of Indian medicine and how Indian medicine has contributed to the medicine in general. If I have to talk about Indian medicine, some of the very notable features that I remember about Indian medicine are that it is claimed that the British cosmetic surgeons learned the art of rhinoplasty from Indians. So Indians were already doing rhinoplasty, and the British surgeons learned the art of rhinoplasty from the Indian surgeons. Ayurveda and Siddha are the medicine systems which are truly of Indian origin. So Ayurveda was practiced in India since a very, very long time. Ayurveda is basically considered to be a subset of Atharvaveda. So Ayurveda was derived from the parent body, and it basically deals with treating diseases with herbs and sherbs, and it has the Tridosha theory of disease that we'll be seeing. The Hindu god of medicine is Dhanvantri. Again, a very common MCQ, can be asked anywhere. You will see a lot of clinics are named after this name. So the Hindu god of medicine is Dhanvantri. Then there was a famous doctor in Indian medicine whose name was Charak, or Charaka in English, if you have to say that. Charaka mentioned in his very early treatise that he had a mention about Indian snake root, which is also known by the name of Respirin. Now, if you are students of pharmacology, you know that this is a antihypertensive drug, and you also know that this is not used these days. But yes, in those days it was a very good antihypertensive drug, and it was described as early as when Charaka lived in India. So that was his contribution. Sushruta, I am sure many of you will already be knowing that Sushruta is the father of Indian surgery. He pioneered many surgical practices in India, and he was the father of Indian surgery. If you read the text, you will find that probably he was the guy who started stitching wounds. And how he stitched wounds was also very interesting. He used very big ants. He used to approximate the incision, and he used to make the ants bite on the two ends of the incision, and then used to cut off the heads of the ant. So the ant went in rigor mortis, and that is the way he sutured. So Indians were very fairly advanced in the method of science. As I told you, Ayurveda deals with the Tridosh theory of disease. Tridosh means Vat, Pitta and Kapha. So we believe that the balance between Vat, Pitta and Kapha gives you a harmonious health. Coming to the next slide, you see homeopathy. A lot of you might have been treated with homeopathy. Homeopathy was pronounced by Samuel Hahnemann, and it is very popular science. India claims to have the largest number of homeopathy practitioners all around the world. So India has a lot of homeopathy practitioners and very famous practitioners, one of the very good branches of science making a lot of money is homeopathy in India. And the philosophy of homeopathy is that the treatment of diseases is done by small amounts of drug that in a healthy person produces symptoms similar to that of the disease being treated. So the philosophy in homeopathy is that you give small amount of drug and the side effect of that drug is the very symptom of the disease. So when you have the disease, a drug is given which produces the similar symptom in a small quantity and you have the cure. So that is the philosophy of homeopathy. Coming to the next slide, we'll talk about Chinese medicine. Notable thing about Chinese medicine is Chinese people still believe a lot in their medicine. Like Indian people do, a lot of Indian people still take Ayurveda, they still go to homeopaths. So similarly, Chinese people also have a deep-rooted belief in their medicine system. And they have a theory like Indians have with the Tridosh theory, they have the Yang and the Yin. You have seen a lot of Chinese films, you have seen films of Jackie Chan and you know already what Yang and Yin is. The Yang is believed to be an active masculine principle and the Yin is believed to be a negative feminine principle. Again, the balance between these two opposing forces means good health. For just a side note here for those who follow tattoo or that kind of stuff, you have a Chinese symbol like this and you have one eye here and one eye here, and this symbolizes the harmony between the Yang and the Yin. A lot of people have tattoos like this or they have some charms or amulets consisting of the very same symbol of the Yang and the Yin. So that is Chinese medicine for you. Still very prevalent, also very knowledgeable people in medicine. Chinese were the pioneers of immunization, as you can see on the slide. In fact, the immunization for smallpox, the very and the only disease that has been eradicated from planet Earth is smallpox. These were the pioneers of immunization for smallpox. So Chinese people had this knowledge very early in their lives that smallpox can be controlled by immunization. And there is a very famous Chinese saying that a great doctor is not the one who treats someone who is ill, but someone who is not yet ill. If you ask me, this is a very fairly recent health concept. No, very recently we come to understand that preventive medicine is much better than curative medicine. Like you say, prevention is better than cure. So Chinese people were the first to recognize that not falling ill is better than falling ill and then getting a cure out of it. Coming to the next slide, we'll see a brief about Egyptian medicine. As you know, Egypt was a very ancient civilization. They have developed a lot of things. They have developed pyramids and, you know, talents that were far outgrown at their time. Similarly, in medicine, they were far more curious, far more explorative than others. The only downfall of Egyptian medicine, if you ask me, was that exploration of the body was prohibited and preservation of the body was practiced. So you know that the famous art of mummification of Egyptian bodies. So you have a mummy. So that hampered Egyptian medicine because they were not able to dissect anybody. So Egyptian medicine prohibited dissections of the human body. So they were fairly advanced for their time. Egyptians had modern concepts of prevention and disease that we have right now. One of the notable features or figures that you need to know about Egyptian medicine is this guy called as Imhotep, used and overused in film. So you already have heard about this name. I don't think that it will be a challenge for you to remember this name, Imhotep. Imhotep was the most noted physician of Egyptian medicine. He was not only a physician, he was an architect, he was a doctor, he was a godman, he was a priest, you name it and you have it. So Imhotep was a doctor as well as a divinity. So he was almost worshipped as a god. So he is one of the legendary figures of Egyptian medicine that you should know if you have an MCQ on this. Egyptians also had the knowledge of immunization. They had proposed initially that disease was the result of absorption of harmful substances from the intestine. And later on now we know that yes, many of the diseases not exactly are born from this mode, but the gut is a seat of lot of infections and you get a lot of infections because of the GIT. They also had this very wonderful concept that pulse is the speech of the heart, and I could not have agreed more that pulse is the speech of the heart. Okay, some other notable achievements. They built planned cities with public baths and underground drains. They had some knowledge about smallpox, mosquito nets, plague, and some other notable diseases of their times. Coming to the next slide, the Greek medicine. As you know, all that is Greek is good. Again, Greeks have contributed a lot to medicine also. Greeks, basically, if you have to sum them up in one word, taught people the why and how of medicine. So they were the first people who challenged people to think about diseases in the way that why is this disease, how is this disease, why is it spreading, what are the control measures. So these were the guys who first started that scientific approach towards medicine. Now we are moving away from the supernatural theory of disease. Now we are starting to explore the causes of disease per se. So Greeks were the first to do that. Asclepius, again another celebrated Greek entity. He bore two daughters named as Hygieia and Panacea. Actually, people claim that this is where in Greek medicine the dichotomy between the curative and the preventive medicine started. Hygieia was worshipped as the goddess of health, my goddess, if you have to say like that, community medicine, preventive medicine, public health. So Hygieia is my goddess. People who will be coming after me, the clinicians, their goddess happens to be Panacea, who is the goddess of medicine or curative medicine. So the staff of Asclepius, entwined by the serpent, continues to be the symbol of medicine. The Greeks taught the people to think in terms of why and how, and the dichotomy between preventive and the curative medicine started from the Greeks. Again, few legends of Greek medicine. First was Hippocrates. All of you willingly or unwillingly know him. He was and is and will be called as the father of medicine. Hippocratic oath, we all have to take it before we get our degrees. So this is also one of the names you simply cannot forget about a doctor. Even a layman knows what a Hippocratic oath is. Hippocrates studied and classified disease on the observations, and he also did reasonings. As I said, these were the people who started reasoning. These were the people who started inquiry about the causative agents of the disease. They started application of clinical methods in medicine. Hippocratic oath has become the keystone of medical ethics. You have a lot of ethical issues today. Let us not go into that because that will cover hours and hours of discussion. But this still is the keystone of the medical ethics that we follow. And if you ask me, the ethics that he said at his point of time were very fairly advanced and still are relevant. He was also an epidemiologist. He also explained the causes of disease in terms of climate, in terms of diet, in terms of habits that people have. Coming to the next slide, we will talk about Roman medicine. Roman medicine, they basically borrowed a lot about from the Greek medicine. It's like we borrowed a lot of from British. British left us. We borrowed a lot of British knowledge. Romans followed Greeks. Greeks ruled the world. Afterwards, Romans came into rule. So Romans borrowed a lot of knowledge from the Greeks, and they pioneered sanitation by the Romans. So one of the notable figures of Roman medicine, again, Galen observed that the disease is due to three factors: predisposing, exciting, and environmental factors. Again, a very modern idea, very true. You have triggering factors, you have predisposing factors, and you have factors which promote the disease further. So that is Galen for you, who had proposed this theory at his time. Galen was literally called as the medical director of his times, and this is also again very true. What Galen preached continued to be the standard of medical care for centuries together. So Galen was a prolific writer. He has a lot of publications to his name, and what he told for his times continued to be followed for centuries, not decades. Next, legends of Roman medicine is Fracastorius, who proposed the theory of the contagion, told us that syphilis was transmitted during sexual relations. Again, start of epidemiology. Therefore, he is also called as the founder of epidemiology. An MCQ which can pop up time and again, who is the father of epidemiology. Andreas Vesalius, these legends, I'm sure many of you have already heard their name. Andreas Vesalius was the first man of modern science. Next is the great Ambrose Paré. He is the father of surgery. So he is the one who proposed, who experimented a lot of surgical procedures at his time, and he is the father of surgery. Harvey, a gentleman who discovered the circulation of blood. Again, these, I talk about it as if it is very easy. At their point of time, it was not easy at all. Because as I told you, a lot of times, it was a taboo to dissect the body. It was a taboo to open up the body. And these guys broke that taboo. And these guys did discoveries for us which if they had not done would have changed the shape of medicine as we know now. So Harvey discovered the circulation of the blood. He was the one who saw that there is a central pump and then the blood goes into the arteries and comes back to the heart by a vein. Today there is nothing great about it, but at that point of time it was a very, very big discovery. Okay, you have Leeuwenhoek, who discovered the microscope, basically assembled few crude lenses, saw through them. He saw some big things. He saw organic matter and he saw still bigger things, and he was able to see microorganisms in very, very primitive shape. So this was where we had entered into the microbiological world. Then you have Jenner's vaccination against smallpox, a legendary step. As you know, we have already eradicated smallpox. I'll be telling you this time and again, smallpox is the only disease which has been eradicated from the face of the planet. We have not been successful in eradicating any other disease. Diseases that have been eradicated by themselves are a different story, but as a humans, this is the only disease that we have managed to eradicate. Cholera is famously called as father of public health, and if you ask me, this is something that you must know. It is a must know. Okay, it is a father of public health, but this is not a person. Cholera is a disease. Okay, so cholera is called as the father of public health. So just a minute that you need to know. John Snow studied the epidemiology of cholera in London. Another legend, we'll be talking about him over and over again. Just to give you a brief idea about what John Snow did. John Snow's contribution to epidemiology notably was the spot map. Okay, so say just a crude diagram. This is the shape of London, and John Snow divided London into two areas. One which was supplied by a water company and the other which was supplied by another water company. So this area derived its water supply from one particular company. You need not know the name of that water company, and this was supplied by another company. And what John Snow did was, at his point of time, he marked the people who had this disease. Okay, so what John Snow did was he did spot mapping. So he said that, okay, let me map the people who have the disease on a map and let's see if this works out. And the map that he came out with looked something like this. Okay, so get the idea. The idea is that most of the people who have the disease are concentrated to one side of the city, and that side of the city is sharply coinciding with the water supply of that part of the city. So this was a legendary invention for that time. What happened was, we came to know that spot mapping is a very good tool for epidemiology and has been used since then. Okay, so that is what John Snow did. This is again important, has been asked and will be asked time and again. Role of polluted drinking water in the spread of cholera, John Snow, germ theory of disease. Now again, we are moving ahead in time. Now we are talking about the germ theory of disease. Till now, what we have basically talked about is supernatural theory of disease, some other agents. Now, because we have a microscope, we could see microbiological organisms. We are moving into the time which is called as the germ theory of disease. Every disease has an agent. This is not true right now, but at that point of time, this was true. So that is essentially germ theory of disease. You have tuberculosis, you have Mycobacterium tuberculosis. You have leprosy, you have Mycobacterium leprosy. You have cholera, you have Vibrio cholera. So germ theory of disease is cause effect. I have a bacteria, I have a disease. That is the evolution. Again, because we had a microscope, we could see those microbes, we had the evolution of germ theory of disease. Louis Pasteur demonstrated the presence of bacteria in air. This guy did a lot of other things also. This is one of the many things that he did. Birth of preventive medicine. A whole era has gone. We are entering into a new era, the era of preventive medicine. James Lind, again, you would have heard about this. This guy did a very interesting experiment when he was a doctor in a naval ship. What he did was that a lot of sailors on his ship started bleeding through their mouths and ears, and he was very curious about it. Okay, so what is this disease? They were falling ill repeatedly, and he did a very simple experiment. He segregated people into two groups and he fed citric fruits to one group and he did not feed the citric groups fruits to the other group. So the people who were eating those citrus fruits were called as, funnily, limeys, and the other ones were called as non-limeys. So lime containing fruits and non-lime containing fruits. And he saw that the limeys were protected from this disease and all the non-limeys got the disease. A very beautiful experiment, outstandingly successful. Today we know that scurvy is caused because of deficiency of vitamin C and the sailors were suffering from the manifestations of scurvy. So again, this guy did not know the name of the disease, he did not know the clinical manifestations of the disease, he did not know the natural history of the disease, neither he know that what was he looking for. Yet he was able to cure the disease. So this is the beauty of epidemiology. Okay, this is the beauty of epidemiological approach. You may not know a thing about the disease and still you are contributing to it as a science. So James Lind did this beautiful experiment which taught us a lot about investigation into a disease. Next is Edward Jenner, discovered vaccination against smallpox. So he is the one who standardized the vaccination and then propagated it. One of the cornerstones of smallpox vaccination is undoubtedly the vaccine, and he is the person who should be credited about it. Check the last one on the slide is Dr. Ross, who demonstrated that malaria was transmitted by Anopheles mosquito. Another interesting vignette, this Dr. Ross did this while he was in India. He had dedicated a lot of time in India. It was his time in India that Ross discovered that malaria was transmitted by the Anopheles mosquito. Next is modern medicine. Newer diseases challenge the germ theory of disease. Factors or causes in etiology of disease, newer factors came into play, like social factors, economic factors, genetic factors, environmental and psychological factors. And there is a long list, we'll be seeing that list in the next class. Newer concepts are multifactorial causation of disease. Again, we'll be talking at length about the multifactorial causation of disease. Petrenkov has proposed this theory a long back. In fact, he proposed this theory when germ theory was on evolution. So unfortunately, you know, if you have successful hits of one hero or heroine, nobody gives a chance to a struggler. Okay, so this is exactly what happened with this guy. Okay, germ theory was a hit. You had a hero for every film. You had Mycobacterium tuberculosis for tuberculosis, and this concept, which was very right, got submerged. So although he was right, he could not propagate his theory much because at that time germ theory was taking its foothold.